Hi, everyone. Today, I'm going to talk about Firecracker, Booker, and its integration with container runtime managers. So, yeah, my name is Dong Su Park. I'm working at Kentwerk, which is based in Berlin, Germany. So far, I have been working on container runtimes mainly, and I work also on Flatcha Linux and Kubespun. So all are open source projects. Last year, my colleague Alban and I have been working on especially the OCI runtime tools and distribution specs and so on. That's why I have been interested in container runtimes. So if you are interested in many interesting open source projects at Kentwerk, then feel free to contact us. So I'm going to talk about Firecracker today. This is a very recent project which was developed a little time ago, but open sourced in December last year. So simply speaking, it's a lightweight virtualization machine monitor. So we call it VMM. You can spawn multiple micro VMs in an efficient way. So without relying on the existing QMOK VMs or hardware emulation layers in between. And it's dedicated to short-lived workloads. So you can say that micro VMs triggered by Firecracker would last for a couple of seconds or minutes, so not like it's 24 hours. And yeah, this is a good balance between traditional virtual machines and containers, because so many people believe in the, the virtual machines are better than containers because of the isolation and security issues. Firecracker achieves security and isolation issues by implementing jailer in itself. So you can specify a whitelist of system calls using seccomp, which is provided by Linux kernel itself. That's pretty cool. And so obviously, Firecracker heavily makes the use of Linux KVM interface, so its interface is just exposed via native SDK. And this is implemented all in Rust. So I think the recent discussion about this is that so Amazon and Intel have been working on a shared interface, which is called Rust VMM. So yeah, yesterday there was a talk about that. Maybe I'm not expert about the Rust VMM, so you can ask one of the Rust VMM members. Yeah, that is so. This is a simple example of how you can run Firecracker and how to launch the micro VMs. So first you run Firecracker daemon without the API socket option. So you can just skip this option, omit this and run it. Then the temp firecracker.socket will be the default Unix socket that Firecracker listens on. And after that, you can specify two very important requirements. The first one is about specifying kernel image. And the second one is about the rootfs image. So you have to prepare the two different images on your local machine. And you can, you have to specify for the first one, the boot source URL. For the second one, the rootfs, /rootfs URL. The other ones are very similar to each other. And yeah, that's it. So this is a basic preparation for running Firecracker. After that, after all operations were done, you can actually start the micro VM, which is also done by this RESTful API through the Unix socket. This is instant start action. So you have to specify actions in the URL, and you need to specify action type to instant start. Then the micro VM will boot. I'll show this in the later demo. So this is not actually human friendly at all, and maybe you would think about an easier way. So many people have been already working on it, so integration with container managers. The first one is obviously Containerd, which is pretty widely used and widely known. Under Firecracker VM, the micro VM organization, there is a Git repository, Firecracker Containerd repo. Yeah, this repository is about implementing three different components: agent, snapshotter, and runtime. And after that, you need to install the containerd specific shim into your local directory. Then that will enable the containerd to be integrated with Firecracker. And this depends on the TTRPC interface of the containerd. So if you are interested in, you can look into this project. And very recently, there is another attempt to integrate Kata container with the Firecracker. You can visit this pull request. This is already merged, and you can use it already. And yeah, very clean implementation, and I can recommend it. And on the other hand, this heavily relies on existing Kata containers interface, like hypervisors and so on. So it's not like a lightweight approach, I would say. So I was thinking about a very simple way, how to integrate in a simple way. So Cryo would be the best approach for me. That's what I thought. So what's the Cryo? Cryo achieves both container runtime standard, which are OCI and CRI. OCI is, simply speaking, this is a spec for open container initiatives, and its reference implementation is RunC. Maybe if you are running Docker in your local machine, for example, then you are already running RunC, because 99% of usage is like running RunC for the OCI runtime. So Cryo already implements this. And on the other hand, Kubernetes itself, Kubernetes 1.8 or newer, already has this container runtime interface, which is CRI. This is done for supporting both container runtimes, Docker and Rocket. And yeah, this is a de facto standard for container runtimes, and that wants to be integrated with Kubernetes. And yeah, Cryo itself achieves CRI, and at the same time, it's relatively simple in compared to the Containerd or any other solutions. So that's what I chose to implement. And Cryo itself does not have any command line tools, so maybe the best way to install Cryo Control, another command line tool. Cryo Control is a part of Cryo Tools repo, so you can visit this repo. This provides a very simple and similar command line interface shown to users as RunC or Docker. So my goal is to make a runtime add-on in Cryo for Firecracker. Currently, Cryo has a single runtime for which is V1 and should be renamed to OCI in the future. And the second approach, which is written in this pull request, which is for supporting VM-based container runtime. This is still in progress, not merged yet. But it improves internal interface of Cryo. So what I want to do is to take a similar approach as this VM-based container runtime inside Cryo. And at the same time, I'm not doing anything like connecting to the VM-based container runtime, but I'm just running Firecracker under the scene. That's what I want to do. For doing that, I'm relying on Firecracker's Go SDK. This is also a very good and thin layer between the Firecracker itself and container runtimes or any other third-party applications. And Firecracker is written in Rust, and so I like Rust, but honestly, I'm not good at programming Rust. So Go SDK is a very good approach solution for me. It allows me to write a third-party application using Go language, and then it's easy to be integrated with existing container runtimes because most container runtimes are written in Go. And it provides a low-level KVM functionalities in an easy way. So you can take a look at this repo. So I can show you a simple diagram. Cryo on the left side, Cryo daemon should be running with my own Firecracker runtime add-on. And on the right side, Firecracker daemon should be running in the background. So each daemon listens on its own unique socket. So what I do is actually running cryo-control command line tool from my command line. Then it should connect to the Cryo's Unix socket and send specific commands to that Unix socket. Then Cryo interprets this command based on Firecracker Go SDK, then sends the commands to Firecracker backend. And Firecracker backend also listens on its own Unix socket, and whenever it receives the command, it spawns a new micro VM. So if you do this process multiple times, or 10 times, or 100 times, then the Firecracker daemon would spawn micro VMs 10 times or 100 times. So arbitrary times, you can do it as you want. Current proof of concept is available as open source. Branch is kinfork/cryo/my branch name. And this basically reads config file for setting up kernel and rootfs for Firecracker. And yeah, this can be also done manually, but it should be human friendly and configurable. So I had to add it. Also, so whenever starting a container, for example, so Firecracker, Cryo runtime would also tell Firecracker to spawn a new process, micro VM process. This branch itself is partly working, but it's still in heavy development. So in the future, maybe it might be changing. So yeah, in the future, I'm going to clean up something and make a pull request to the upstream repo. On the other hand, there is a simple tool for creating kernel and rootfs image. So as I shown a little before, there is an example for setting up kernel image and rootfs. So you should really have two different images, not a single image. So I had to create these two different images using a simple tool based on the simple Docker file to create vmlinks.bin and rootfs.x4. This is not no special thing. So this is just a stock kernel, so no special patches. And this is a normal rootfs file image based on the X4 file system. I'm going to show demo. Is it enough? First of all, I'm going to show just a plain simple firecracker demo. In that process, Cryo is not involved at all. After that, the second step is integrating with Cryo and configuring and running Cryo control commands and so on. And the first demo is just running a firecracker. So this is my local repository, including just an upstream firecracker repo. So there is this is a binary file that I want to run, and these are two different images. One is kernel and the other one is rootfs. So first of all, I want to clean up the existing socket file. And after that, I want to run. Yes, it's running. Now check if it's really running. Yes, it's running. And also, yeah, Unix socket is active, listening. The first preparation is specifying kernel image. So it will send a specific command, kernel root image path and boot arguments. So these things are can be specified in an arbitrary way. So you can just configure as you want. Also, you need to specify this boot source URL and put method. Yes, 204 results is good. So it has worked. You cannot see it right now. Now, the second preparation is about rootfs. Let me see. Yes, this looks similar, but you have to specify a different URL here with the drive slash rootfs, and you have to specify your absolute path to existing rootfs image. Yes, it has worked. Still, I'm seeing nothing. This is normal. So until I really start and send an instant start action, So you don't see anything. So until the preparations, this is just a normal process. The final step is actually sending instant start. Yeah, looks similar, but this is the URL has actions and action type is instant start. Yes, this is normal, and you can see that now the Minecraft VM has already booted. This is just a normal Debian unstable image. Kernel is also that one from Debian Unstable. It's been booted. And you can see anything that you want. And I specified the total memory to 128 bytes, so you can see the memory usage like that. And if I just type reboot, then the micro VM would be gone, and you will not see anything. Micro demon, yeah, it's gone. Yeah, that's all. So it's a very simple example, and actually you are able to specify many other parameters. For example, second block device or another virtual net interface. I will skip this demo here, but maybe you will get the idea. Now, thanks. Second part of demo is about the integration with Cryo. So this is the Cryo repository and my custom branch, and there is a binary file, Cryo daemon. I'm going to run it with some configuration file, which is predefined like that, or like that. So for example, if I look into this configuration file, then you will see the normal configuration. So it will pull an image from Cray.io and run some commands using the environment variables. And this is just a normal cryo config. And I'm going to run cryo daemon also. On the other terminal, I'm going to send several cryo control command. First of all, running, you can see cryo daemon is running, and let's see. So there are no sandbox pod is available, also no container is available. The first command is creating and running sandbox pod. So before running actual container, you need to specify a sandbox config. This is the first step. Now the pod is ready. Now the cryo daemon shows the several messages. And this is mostly about the sending an instant start messages and so on. So it's communication between cryo and firecracker daemon. You can see firecracker daemon is running. Also cryo daemon will be running. Now the second step is creating a container using that pod, sandbox pod. What I did was actually using this existing pod ID specify two different configs. One is container config, and the second one is the sandbox config. So far, I have just one container running, which is in the created state, so not actually running now. But you can see also that this action was done. And with that created container, I'm going to start the container actually. So it's started. I'm going to run just ps. Yeah, you can see that it's now in running state. Now CryoDaemon is also saying that it has done something about this, and yeah, it got a 204 status as a response. Yes, it's that, and I'm going to stop the container first, and container, I'm going to delete the container. Yep. That has succeeded. Now you can see that the container is now gone. Yes, no container at all. But you can see still the pulse is running. And the firecracker daemon is only running just once because the second instance was already removed. Now I'm going to remove the pulse itself again. Stop it. So it's stop and removed. Now the pod is gone. Yeah, this is a known issue, so I'm going to figure out in the next few days. So yeah. Anyway, this should actually kill the existing firecracker daemon. So I'm going to just remove this. Yes, it's terminated. Yeah, that's the end of my demo. Thanks for listening to my talk, and I'm going to quickly go over the future work. So I'm going to publish this rebranch as an actual pull request and get some feedback from the upstream maintainers. There are also missing features like attach or exit, so I'm going to follow up with that. And also, that's a good idea to do the similar work for example, Rocketlet. Yeah, this is to be discussed. That's it.
So we can do one question, and you were the first one.
I have a question specifically to Firecracker itself. I don't understand what makes it limited to micro VM and short life. Why it cannot be a general hypervisor?
I think so. In general, Firecracker is designed to be living just for a short period. And for example, serverless workloads, that was the purpose of Firecracker. That's what it does the job in the best shape. So, sure, you can also adapt and use Firecracker for other use cases. And I think it's not impossible, but on the other hand, Firecracker upstream maintainers would think about this Firecracker very, wants to keep it very simple and minimal. So if you want to use it as a container, for example, or another feature, then it might be a little trouble because Firecracker maintenance was not think about that. Does that answer for your question?
Yeah, thank you.